Now, unfortunately, you've seen the word secant before, and it has nothing to do with this word secant. So it's got two completely different unrelated definitions. So when you see the word secant line together, obviously the secant function is not a line. So it's not referring to that secant function, the 1 over cosine. So this secant line intersects a function in two points, in two specific points. So it's a line. Of course, you could think y equals mx plus b. When I put, let's call this a cloud or a bubble around something, that means something you should remember from before. I know you probably had 3 years of this somewhere between middle school and high school. So we got a line that intersects the graph of some function in two points. And we can call these x1 comma fx1, and the other one we'll call, actually let's go x0 fx0 and x1 fx1. So first of all, have you made found the equation of a line between two points before in a math class? Oh yeah. You definitely did in pre-calculus 1 and probably 3 or 4 classes before that. So you've taken two points, made a line. What property of the line did you generally find first? You usually find the slope first, and then you use that and one of the points to get the y-intercept. If you're lucky, one of the points might be on the y-axis, and you can just say, oh, that's the y-intercept right there. But generally, you find slope first, and then find your either y-intercept, or you could also, shouldn't forget the other form. The other form looks like y minus y1 equals m x minus x1. So depending on which way you like to go, you could use either one of those two. So one of those is point slope, I think, and the other one's slope intercept. If you have trouble remembering where the top one comes from, it comes from the difference of y's and x's, basically. So that's exactly where slope comes from. And, oh no, I use a triple equal sign, I think, in this class, or have I not used it? I think I've used it. So I can say those top two equations tell me the exact same information. Of course, what will it fail for anytime the two x coordinates are the same thing? You'll be divided by 0. So that's a vertical line, undefined slope. But if you think about functions, graph of functions, are we ever going to be able to pick two points on a graph of a function that are above and below each other that share an x-coordinate? Better not, or you don't have a function. So we won't have vertical lines creeping up as secant lines. Some weird stuff can happen at tangent lines, which we'll get to in a minute. So let's define tangent line before we get into computations. So unfortunately, you've seen the word tangent before. And this tangent, and that tangent obviously is not a line. It's a curve, or lots of curves. So tangent line is completely different and unrelated to the tangent function. So of course, this is also a line, which could be in some different forms. But this line, this intersects the graph of y equals f of x. But this one intersects in one point. And we can just call this x naught fx naught. So it not only intersects in one point, and at this point, the line has the same slope as the graph of x. F of x. So how do we know about the slope of the graph of x, or f of x? That's what we found yesterday when we looked at that sequence of numbers that was going towards 32. And we said, oh, the slope of this graph is most likely 32. So that would be how we get the slope. So what do they look like? Let's draw some quick pictures. I'll use a black for the curve. So this will be y equals f of x. So a tangent line, I'll draw in blue. There's two separate points, and your tangent line is supposed to go through both of those. Tangent line goes through both of these points.
That's a tangent line?
Secant line. Secant line, yes. So in blue, that's your secant line. So a secant line intersects in two points. That's what a secant line is. Now, I didn't write the word exactly 2 points, or only 2 points, because this function could very well, maybe it curves back down like this, and then all of a sudden, our line incidentally hit a third place. That function might keep curving around and hit 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times. So it could hit in more than 2 points. But secant line, there's two specific points that it intersects. And then whatever else it hits, that's okay. So I'm going to erase that extra part of the graph up there. So there could be more than 2 points, but it intersects in two specific points. Looking further ahead, this gets into what's called the mean value theorem. You don't need to write any of this green stuff down. So don't write any of the green marker down. This point that I just highlighted on the graph looks like it has the same slope as our secant line. Neither of the 2 points that actually intersected have the same slope as our secant line, but there is a point between those two that has the same slope, and that's what we call the mean value theorem. And we'll talk about that plenty when we get there. So tangent line, I will attempt to draw the same curve. But now, I don't pick 2 points, I pick 1 point. You don't get to pick 2 points on your tangent curve, you get to pick exactly one. Now, I want the slope of the tangent line to be the same as the slope of the curve. So for that, I'm going to zoom in and do my best to make a line that's as close to the actual slope of the curve as I possibly can. And we'll use FooPlot to plot out a graph and the tangent line and zoom in properly and see how flat the actual curve looks when we zoom in. So the limit to zooming in is right there for what I can do on the screen. So we'll go zoom in much further using FooPlot. All right, so that's tangent and secant line. These are new definitions unrelated to tangent and secant you saw before. So you may need to make note cards or do extra homeworks to remember them. So we're going to find the slope of a function and then the tangent line at the point. Do we actually compute? We'll do a secant line down here too. Let's make this easier and use x as positive 1. That'll eliminate negative sign and make the algebra, the arithmetic, a little easier. So first thing we need for a line is a slope. So let's try to figure out the slope of this function. We could start out with a very quick graph. 1 over x. There is a whole other part of the graph that's in the negative x and y quadrants, quadrant 3, but I'm only going to worry about the quadrant 1 part. So I can go ahead and draw what I think the tangent line is going to look like. Something like that. So we're going to draw what I think tangent line will look like. But first, I need to get the, well, I can right away write down the point it's going to go through. So this point right here is definitely x coordinate 1. And what is the y coordinate? So all we have to do is take 1 and f it. So the point our line is going to go through is 1, 1. So all I need is the slope now, which is the hard part. So we're going to get the slope. So there's two ways we can do it. We can find the slope. We could do average rate of change, which is for x in the interval a to b. So it's average rate of change. FB minus FA over B minus A. And I can choose A and B. So definitely one of them should be 1. Let's go with A as 1 and then B is a little bit more. I could go B as 1 and A is a little less. But I'm just going to choose to go I could have chosen b equals 1, and in that case, a would be a number less than 1, but not very much less than 1, like 0.9. All right, so choose a as 1, and then first, let's do b as 1.1. So we're going to do average rate of change from 1 to 1.1. So we got f of 1.1 minus f of 1 divided by 1.1 minus 1. And 1.1 minus 0.1 is 1.1 minus 1 is 0.1. So how do we deal with fractions? Common denominator. So if you haven't done common denominator with decimal fractions, all you need to do is basically I need to multiply by 1.1 over 1.1 on this fraction, so I can add them. The 0.1 on the denominator, I'm going to write that as 1/10. That's what 0.1 is. So 1 minus 1.1. That's minus 0.1 over 1.1. And I'm going to multiply by the reciprocal of 1/10, which is 10 ones.
Are you multiplying in the bottom, the left side, 1 point, and then there's another one after that?
Just
More lower than that.
So I subtracted 1 minus 1.1. And that's negative 0.1?
Yeah, right under the first thing you said.
This?
No. The denominator or the numerator. I can't remember.
This?
Yeah.
That's because...
Oh, that's 1.1.
So we match denominators so we can subtract. So multiply the numerator by 10, and you get minus 1 over 1.1. And 1.1, that's 11 tenths. And 10 tenths, and cancel, negative 10, 11. So it doesn't seem... Oh, because that's not the slope at the point. That's the slope between those two points. That's why it's not. I was expecting negative 1. So this is getting close. All right, so that took a while right there. I think if I went from 1 to 1.01, that would quite possibly take even longer. So let's do the algebraic route instead. So I got a decent approximation. Let's use algebra instead. On the difference quotient. So our difference quotient looks like this. You can replace x by 1. 1 is the x value that we are considering. So we already established x equals 1 as our x value that we wanted to look at. So just replace all the x's by 1. Now I'm going to plug in all of these. The one you need to be careful about is the function composition, f of 1 plus h. So let's talk about good ways to plug it in and really bad ways. So pre-calculus class, we did a pre-calculus 1, we did function composition. Not so much in pre-cal 2, though. So function composition, our original f of x was 1 over x. So if you feed f a box, you get 1 over whatever's in the box. I'm doing this because I see I need to plug in 1 plus h. So all I'm going to do is put 1 plus h inside the box. You need to make the box a lot bigger so it fits. Now it's a little bit silly to write out math with boxes around. So instead of boxes, we can use parentheses to group stuff together. So that's just 1 over 1 plus h right there. So that's f of 1 plus h. All right, let's do the wrong function composition. So adding an h at the end, it's not what to do. So it is not 1 over 1 plus h. You say it like that, but the plus h appears in the denominator. What is this equal to? This is equal to something, which is f of 1 plus h. So again, you say it the same way, but you're going to treat h very differently. So don't do the what's in the red down here. That is not how to get difference quotient. And just to warn you, if you keep doing that, what will this cancel out to? Let me divide it all by an h. So this f of 1 cancels out negative f of 1. You get h over h, which is 1. So if you get a difference quotient, it reduces to 1, you most likely made this mistake. So keep that in mind. If you got 1, you're very happy. Oh, look, it worked out really well. It's 1. Generally, it's not going to be 1. So if you got 1, you probably did this exact mistake. You did the plus h outside. All right, so there's my warning to you and how you will see it happen as you get a 1 for your difference quotient. So I'm not going to make that mistake over here. So we have 1 over 1 plus h minus 1 over 1. I'll just write that as 1 divided by h. All right, so first of all, we have fraction of fractions. So that's generally a bad move. So let's multiply by the reciprocal of the denominator. So the denominator is h. We'll set it up so h could have a reciprocal, which will be 1 over h. It's easy to see. It's very tempting to multiply, distribute the 1 over h through. Don't do it. Just leave it outside. So do not distribute. One of the main reasons is it is our goal to get rid of the h in the denominator. So it's our goal to get rid of the h. If you distribute it, it's going to appear in two or more places. So what you're trying to get rid of is going to appear lots of different places. And it's going to make it harder to get rid of it. What we're going to do instead is common denominator, just like we did before. So there's negative 1 with the common denominator, 1 plus h. So we get 1 minus 1 plus h divided by 1 plus h. 1 minus 1 is 0. And we just have minus h over 1 plus h. What algebra can I do now to simplify?
Cancel the h's.
Do they cancel out to 1 or negative 1? Negative 1. One of them is negative, and the other one is just h by itself. So they do cancel, but if you just cross them out, you want to make sure you pay attention to that negative sign that's there. Well, that's pretty simple right there. You're going to find that most difference quotients that I give you are going to get relatively simple after a while. You have to go through some steps. Common denominator in this case, we had to FOIL the other one that we did. So we had to expand out and then cancel. All right, so this is the difference quotient with somewhere, x equals 1. So we have our x value of 1. What we need to do is see what happens when this point, 1 plus h, moves closer to 1. And just like before, what that means is h is the difference between the two. So I want that difference to shrink to 0. So we're going to shrink h to 0 now. It's okay to shrink h to 0 because if we look at this step, h equaling 0 doesn't make this divide by 0. If we look back two steps, what happens if I plug in h equals 0 here? We'll get divided by 0, so undefined. Also, if you look at the numerator is basically negative h, so you'll get negative 0 over 0. So when you get 0 over 0, you have to be more clever with your algebra. You don't get to just give up. So let's shrink h to 0 using this right here. So when h approaches 0, this approaches negative 1 over 1 plus 0. Which is just negative 1. So when that h gets really small, this value gets very close to negative 1. So this notation that we're writing down, this is actually calculus limit notation. The way that you're going to see it most of the time, we use the word lim, h approaches 0. So what I wrote here in that green oval means the exact same thing as I wrote in the other green oval. So those tell you the exact same information.
What does lim stand for?
Lim means limit. It's short for limit. I don't know why they left off the last two words. It would have been very reasonable to write limit. But for some reason, mathematicians are obsessed with three-letter words, like all the trig functions are three-letter. Well, they're not really words, but we made them into words. So I don't know what the obsession is with using three-letter abbreviations. All right, so these tell me the same information. So here you can see the h going to 0. Part right there that I circled, and this word limit just says what is happening to this expression when h is getting close to 0. And the answer is on the right side. Oh, yeah. So I forgot to bring that here today. Could we do it right before the other class starts? Before our Calc 2 class starts? All right, so we have a slope. Go ahead and find the line. All you need to do is find either the y-intercept or go point slope form. Either way, find the equation of the line. Any questions on this line right here? I went with the point slope form. It's the slope intercept, but you can go either way, it doesn't matter. This is completely valid as an answer for me or for web work. So both of those two are completely okay. Technically, the one in the middle is correct, but if I ever see on your paper 1 plus 1 and you don't tell me it's 2, that's a little bit silly. So the middle one's correct too, but don't leave it as 1 plus 1. But depending on your favorite form, those two that I put inside the box in the oval, either one's completely okay. Let's go and do a tangent line, or a secant line computation. So we'll take that 1, 1, and let's go with... So we're going to find secant 9. So same function. For x equal 1, and the other one will go x equals 2. Keep it easy. So you can use the same one point we use, and then the other point is right here at 2. So go ahead and take first point. You already know the y value. You get the y value at the second point, and then get a new slope. Won't be the same slope. You can see the slope's a little different right off the graph. That shouldn't be plus a half. So this is a good time to talk about spidey sense. I just made a mistake.
Yeah.
But let's say that I didn't actually see it in the numbers. Let's go ahead and graph this up. So if I graph this secant line, here's 1/2 y-intercept, and slope negative 1/2 is going to look like this right here. It doesn't even touch the graph anywhere. That's definitely not the secant line. So that's what I call your math spidey sense, telling you something's wrong. That line's not where it should be, not hitting the graph. So what I should have done was did a positive 1/2 plus 1, which is 3/2. So if you see 3/2, and now we look at what that turns into. There's 3/2 between 2/2 and 4/2. And slope negative 1/2 will give me the correct line right there. And I intersect this case in two places right there. All right, so questions on getting that tangent line. Probably should zoom out to the computation. So there's the tangent line computation.
Yeah, I have like a question about your error form is y1 minus y2 or y2 minus y1. This log.
Oh, you can write it either way.
Either way, yeah.
As long as your first, as long as if you look, the twos, in this case, the twos are in the front and the ones are in the second place. I could have written it as y1 minus y2 over x1 minus x2. I can switch the order.
I can switch the order.
As long as you're consistent, because if you multiply by negative 1 over negative 1, you'll get the line above. You'll just get negative in the numerator and negative in the denominator.
You don't want to get only the same answer, or what you want to get a different answer?
What I'm saying is those, they have to be vertically lined up like this. So I can choose, there's no reason why one of the points is called point one, the other one's called point two. You don't need x to be bigger or smaller in either of the two cases. You just need x to not be the same value, or you'll have it divide by zero. So it doesn't matter which point you put first or second.
That doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
You want to find only the same answer.
You get the same answer. So you could switch this to be y1 minus y2 as long as it's x1 minus x2 also. I mean, you can find this out pretty quickly by just redoing some of the computations we did, but switch the order of the points. Yeah.
Well,
so we did a quadratic already. Let's get crazy and do a cubic. So secant lines are usually a little faster to find because you don't have to do that extra computation of what exactly is the slope. You just go, here's a point, here's another point, you get the slope in a couple seconds from that slope formula or average rate of change formula. So we'll just do the tangent line. So we'll take the x cubed function at, we'll do this at x equals 2. So you could do this numerically, but we don't have calculator, so it's going to take too long to do this numerically. So we're going to do the simplify the difference quotient and then make h really small. So that's the order we're going to do it. So we're going to do this by simplifying the difference quotient. Which in our case is 2, x is 2. By simplifying the difference quotient. Okay, so we're going to take 2 plus h and cube it. So you probably saw Pascal's triangle at some point, and most likely at that point, your teacher probably did something very unimpressive with it, like wrote the next line down. So let's do something unimpressive. What pattern is happening in Pascal's triangle? I'm going to make the next, fill the next row here. Fours, and where did that four come from? So you're just summing the two numbers that are like diagonally above, basically. So you're writing between every two numbers, you're writing in the next row down their sum. And on the outside part, there's no number up here to look at, so you just sum. You could think of a zero being there. So you're doing 0 plus 1 is 1. So 3 plus 3, 6. 3 plus 1, 4. 1, 5, 10, 10, 5, 1. So it's very easy to write down rows of Pascal's triangle. So why in the world am I doing this? Let's look at row 2. What is row 2 used for? So it is the coefficients, which I should have chose a different color. Coefficients. A plus b cubed. So we're going to get some a squareds. Oop, not a squareds. We'll get no a squareds. We'll get a cubes plus a squared b plus ab squared plus b cubed. And I'm going to fill in coefficients now. Now, what did I do with the powers? I basically wrote it with decreasing powers of a. And if you look at the sum, there's an invisible first power. There's an invisible b to the zero power and an invisible a to the zero power that I'm not writing in. So every term here is degree 3. I'm just not writing in the zero powers and the first powers. So I'm going to go and undo those. I'm just showing you where the pattern comes from. You're writing out all terms with either decreasing powers of A, or you could write it with increasing powers of A, the opposite order. Let's get all that blue stuff out. Now I'm going to write the coefficients out. What are the coefficients? 1, 3, 3, 1. Like that. How can you check this? You could just multiply a plus b times itself three times. Combine like terms, and you'll get this on the right side. So you can check this. You probably want to check it for like 15, but I think checking it for 3 is pretty reasonable. And then believing it for the other ones is reasonable also. So if I did a plus b to the fourth power, I could do the same thing, where your first term will be a to the fourth plus, now I'm looking at the fourth row. Looking at this row. So that'll be 4a cubed b plus 6a squared b squared plus 4ab squared plus b to the fourth. So we can use this shortcut and we'll cube 2 plus h way faster. So use that line right there to cube that way faster. Any questions on what I'm telling you to do so you save a lot of time? So go ahead, expand that out. Hopefully things will simplify and you'll be able to knock out the h in the denominator. I like to think of this h down here as the bad guy. You have to get rid of it. So expand it out, hopefully combine like terms and cancel that h. So how do I actually go about canceling the h in the denominator? I could very carefully cancel some of these h's, but what's a safer algebra move? So we'll factor that h out. So we have 12 plus 6h plus h squared divided by h, and now the h's cancel perfectly. Okay, so this is the difference quotient. This was f of 2 plus h minus f of 2 over h. So any questions? All right, so we got rid of the bad h. That divided by h is gone. Now we can think about what happens when h gets really small. And the answer to that is very obvious. The h terms are going to go away. So if we use that limit notation, we're going to apply the limit to this. So these are slightly, these are, we did our algebra above, now we're going to do our calculus down below. So I'm going to swap out for the difference quotient this 12 plus 6h plus h squared. And now I can very easily see when h is really small, those last two terms disappear. This is just 12 plus 0 plus 0, which is 12. So there's our slope. And find the tangent line to the x cubed function. So you got to find the y coordinate or the f of x coordinate and then write down your linear function. So in this 1 minute while you're computing this, I'm going to go and plot the function and the tangent line on the same graph. All right, so there is the cube, x cube function graph right there. I tried to center it sort of at 2. Anybody feel good about their mx plus b? I know that m is 12. Y-intercept. Nobody? 16, minus 16? Yeah?
Yeah.
All right, so minus 16, obviously, So it will have a y-intercept, negative 16, way down there. What I really wanted to do is zoom in. Let's see if they'll let me do that. If I center the screen on the intersection point at 2, it might let me just zoom in. All right, what happened to the graph and the line? They look almost identical at the zoom. Now I'll zoom out slowly and you'll see. So I think they're off by about a pixel or so on the screen. If I zoom out, you see they're off by maybe 2 pixels at the end. Now they start being off by a little more. And now when I zoom really far out, you can see that they're pretty different. So the idea is the closer you are, the more accurate that line is to your graph. And if you zoom in far enough, at least on this resolution, I can't tell the difference. If I zoom in 8 times or so, they'll look like the exact same line.